Good afternoon, everyone. Hope everyone can hear us. If you can't, just wave your hands crazily and we'll do our best to speak up, okay? Or just wave them anyway. My name is Jonathan LaCour. I'm the Vice President of Cloud at DreamHost. My background is development, engineering, and I've spent the better part of the last 2.5 years learning the plight of an operator and operations. That brings me to Jeremy.
So I've been with DreamHost 14 years. Started out strictly sysadmin, been doing more and more development as you kind of have to do once you get into this OpenStack thing. We're gonna spend some time talking today about exactly what's been going on there and the pitfalls and the bonuses that we've been getting out of everything.
Yep. All right, so first I'll give you a quick introduction to DreamHost itself, if you've not heard of us. We've been around for a long time. In internet years, we're kind of like grandfathers, you know? So 16, 17 years old. We have over 400,000 customers at this point, hosting 1.2 plus million domains on our hosting platform. That's kind of our bread and butter and something we've been doing for a while, and we're really proud of it. And now we're doing cloud services as well. We have a big open source focus. All of our work over the years on our hosting platform has been as a result of the fantastic work that communities have done on things like Linux and Apache, PHP, WordPress. We have over 750,000 WordPress sites hosted at DreamHost. That's a lot of WordPress. That's a lot of PHP. We like to say we kill trees with PHP because of all the CPU that it uses up. So we're also the creators of Ceph, our wonderful friends at Ink Tank, just now over at Red Hat. Sage Weil, the creator of Ceph, was one of our co-founders. So we are very familiar with Ceph, and we're users of Ceph. Big contributors to Solometer, Neutron, Oslo, all sorts of other things. Even myself, the VP, I created a framework called Pecan, which is used by a lot of OpenStack projects now. For the API service. So we're big on open source, and we're an open source or an OpenStack Foundation member. So we're very committed to OpenStack. And I'm gonna give you some caveats here because I'm about to be very candid in this presentation, and so is Jeremy. And we're gonna say a lot of things that talk about some of the troubles we've had with OpenStack. But I wanna be very clear that we're very committed to OpenStack, and we're excited about the community. And all the things we're talking about are from our experiences growing and learning, and we are contributing a lot of fixes back upstream, and we want to share as much of this knowledge with others as possible. I think public cloud is a use case for OpenStack that isn't talked about nearly as much as private cloud, and it has different kind of requirements. And so we're going to try to bring those to light here and help other people help us make OpenStack even better for public cloud. So, in spite of any constructive criticism, we're as committed as ever. So, first I want to talk about the fantasy, right? 2 years ago, when we embarked upon this great journey of getting into OpenStack, what did we have in mind? What were our assumptions? What were our goals? What was our vision for this product? So, the goal was to create DreamCompute, a public cloud built on OpenStack. We felt that the world could really use a public cloud from a smaller player like ourselves. We have, like I said, 400,000 customers. We felt that we could offer them a cloud service that they could really use and enjoy. And we had this great Ceph thing that we had been working on that we really wanted to get out there and use the block storage that is provided in Ceph for our cloud. So the ultimate vision was to be a truly open cloud. We are very open about everything that runs DreamCompute, including what the switching hardware is, what operating system we run on the hosts, what hypervisors are, every single thing about it. All of the code that we use and generate and the cookbooks and the monitoring, we try to open source. We try to give everything back and go upstream. So we really wanted to really create a really open cloud. We wanted to use Ceph for block storage. We are the first public cloud that I know of that is using Ceph for block storage. And that provides some really interesting features that we'll talk about later. We also wanted to get ahead of the game and jump on board virtual networking. This is important for a number of reasons for us, primarily the security that comes with layer 2 isolation for tenants. Every tenant in DreamCompute is going to get their own layer 2 domain, completely virtualized and isolated from every other tenant in OpenStack. We wanted people to be able to create these networks whenever they wanted to, be able to completely program the network. And we also wanted to do that with IPv6 support from the ground up. This is something that was very important to us as a small provider. We don't have millions and millions and millions of IP addresses anymore. And getting them now is actually very difficult. You have to go to auction and buy them for a lot of money. And IPv6 is here, and it's not enough here, but we want to help push that forward. So that was another critical part of our vision, right? And we wanted to have integrated authentication. We wanted that to be a part of the DreamHost kind of family of products. We wanted people to be able to use some of the credentials that they already created, use the same sort of management ability to be able to connect to their OpenStack to DreamCompute. So this was the vision. This is what we had in mind. And now Jeremy's going to walk you through the operations side and the kind of physical side of that vision.
So you can see it's nothing super crazy. We actually use VMware NSX for the network virtualization, as you can
and
see here.
And you probably can't see this diagram, but don't worry. We're going to talk you through it and publish the slides as well.
So that would be the top row of the main compute pods you see. Everything is controlled by a separate hypervisor or control pod, basically three racks in our environment. It's all running, strangely enough, on a VMware cluster. All of our endpoints for the API stuff, the OpenStack, various service nodes, that sort of thing.
We didn't want to start with OpenStack on OpenStack.
Yeah.
We wanted to start with something else, and then we would eventually, the goal is to transition off of that.
Exactly. When starting your first OpenStack cluster, having OpenStack be a dependency is not exactly what you're hoping for. So we decided to go with the tried, true, easy, just buy it, get it
easy.
Up, and get it working solution.
Yeah.
So that runs, Ceph monitors, we've got Chef nodes, all of our central services, the API endpoints for Cinder and for Glance and Nova and Neutron. That's all running in that control pod. Back over to our compute pods. It's basically a giant stack of storage boxes on the bottom. Dell R515s, if you really care, 12 disks each, 3 terabytes. And then a bunch of super beefy AMD hypervisor nodes. Everything's got 64 cores, 192 gigs of RAM. It lets us oversubscribe only 2-to-1 on the CPUs, which is pretty great, and better than most of the other public clouds that we're aware of.
That's over 3,000 cores for those of you doing the math. It's a lot of cores.
For Intel or AMD?
Also AMD. And then all of the networking gear, we decided to try something new. The network layout is terminating layer 3 at the top of every rack, so each layer 2 domain is very, very small. We don't have to worry about any layer 2 redundancy protocols or any of that crap. We just do OSPF between all of our switches. They're all ODM switches, just white box stuff, running Cumulus Linux, 48 10 gig ports and 4 40 gig ports for interconnects between them in a partial mesh. It's pretty awesome. You end up spending $60 a cable instead of $600 from one of the other guys, which is the majority of your savings in the long run.
You get fewer stickers, though.
You get fewer stickers.
Big thing, fewer stickers. Yeah.
Sometimes you might get the wrong sticker.
Yeah,
which
that's
is
also
amusing.
True.
And that has actually been one of the most rock-solid bits of our architecture so far. It's almost a surprise, really, how well it's been working for us.
And all of the architecture decisions we made were really driven by the fact that we're a small team, very small team. We have 2 operations engineers today working on, very tired operations engineers, working on DreamCompute. And that is an incredible feat and a testament to them and some of the decisions we made. But they all weren't necessarily the easiest decisions or the right decisions. So we're going to go through some of the nightmares now.
So clearly, it's OpenStack. It's a giant, complicated problem. Or project, or both. So clearly not everything went the way that we wanted it to from the beginning. The compute side in particular is what I like to consider an onion. Not only are there layers upon layers, but you end up crying a lot. You've got Nova Compute sitting on top of libvirt, sitting on top of QEMU. 99% of the time they talk together great, and then that 1% of the time you're wondering, why is there a QEMU process that nobody thinks should exist, and it's causing some Ceph volume to be unable to be deleted, it's causing ports to stick around in Neutron. The most bizarre things that you never think should happen all tend to happen all at once. To combat that, we've kind of written our own suite of software utilities, Nova auditors, Neutron auditors, Cinder auditors.
Auditors for the auditors.
Yeah.
That's very important, as it turns out.
In fact, maybe we should just name the project IRS.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And bundle it all together. So that's all up on GitHub. I think we posted the link later on.
Yeah.
So continuing on, Nova Network is no more. The future is Neutron. The future is always great and shiny.
Perfect.
And just amazing.
Brand new projects always work great. It is always true.
So we were pretty excited about Neutron, particularly because we're doing a lot of layer 2 virtualization and all this white box stuff, and it's all bleeding edge. And so, you know, you got three parts bleeding edge, you might as well add a fourth, because why not? That's always smart and sexy and exactly what you want to do. Neutron, while it was designed for this sort of thing from the ground up, it kind of wasn't at the same time. They suffer in the same way that a lot of other OpenStack projects suffer, where they are developed by developers who've never run anything, and there's a lot of outside influence coming in from various vendors. So you've got.
And I'm a developer, and I've done that. And I love you guys.
I mean,
all you developers.
I'm an ops guy. I do that when I'm developing something.
Right. We can say the same thing about you crazy people.
So you end up with situations where feature parity between drivers is not, it's almost there, and it's there enough that you always expect it to work, and then it doesn't.
This is a hard, hard problem. So I want to be very clear. We're huge. We're deploying Neutron now. We run it, and we've got it to work for us. Mm-hmm. But it is not an easy problem, and when we first adopted Neutron, it was pretty early. So a lot of progress has been made, and we've been pushing a lot of code there. So.
And in no way is it anything that's, you know, Neutron specific.
Right.
This is something that happens in any complex distributed system. So it's to be expected. You just need to know what to look out for.
So software-defined networking was so great. We were so excited. And there was all these great vendors. Oh, I mean, there was one at the time, or two, or three, maybe. Most of them in stealth mode. We're talking about 3 years here, right? 3 years ago. So we talked to a bunch of different people, and we ended up selecting Nicira, who is now VMware. Which is going to be, I'm still not used to that, but it's pretty cool. Great for them. We're very excited for them about that. And they provide just rock solid L2 network virtualization. So we knew that was the case. They were the people we selected because they provided the best of the basic, right? And it worked really well. But there was this whole need for, you know, L3, right? What if you can't actually route anything? That's kind of a problem. So we talked to them about that, and at the time they didn't really have anything. Since then they have developed some things that provide L3, and that's great and fantastic, but we didn't have time for that. We needed something today. So we went out and we talked to a bunch of vendors who had software routers or some sort of L3 kind of capabilities for us. And it turns out at the time none of them really got it, especially cloud. You go to them and say, I need this for my cloud. And they say, well, how many do you want? I don't know. It depends on on how many instances get fired up and, you know, crushed every day. You know, it's a cloud. You know, it's going to change all the time. Can you bill us by the instance hour? By the what? They didn't get it. And they didn't get open source either. So this was a real problem for us. So, you know, we did what any crazy person would do. And a lot of developers and operators have done and said, well, you know, we can just do that ourselves.
Yeah.
No big deal.
Yeah, that's always the right move. So what we decided to do was start up this project called Akanda. It is a software router, runs as a service VM. So we get automatic distribution thanks to Nova and all this other stuff. It's actually just running OpenBSD and PF. I think OpenBSD 5.4, we're testing 5.5. So we're able to keep pretty up to date with all the latest releases. The routers run one per tenant. You can, it's not great, I'll get to this later. You can add multiple networks on. The process is not super great, thanks to OpenBSD. They also run a RESTful API service, so you can push firewall rules, you can push DHCP, your metadata, all of that. It gets configured on the fly as a push service. In order to maintain all of this, we have what's called the rug, which I think was Mark's name for it.
Yeah, one of our former engineers, Mark McLean, named it, and it's because it ties the whole room together. So if you've seen the Big Lebowski, that's why it's called the rug. It is the service that essentially glues everything together, spins up the routers.
The orchestration of all of our layer 3 services, basically.
Exactly.
It watches on various message queues for events like I've created a new VM, or I've spun up a router, I've added a network, and then it does the appropriate things to the API running on the Akanda image. Now, there are some problems. OpenBSD unfortunately, we found out just very recently, does not actually do network hot plugging. It does PCI hot plugging, and then the PCI devices sit there and don't get configured, which means that we can't simply add new networks to them without a reboot, which is something we're trying to figure out how to overcome.
Right.
It's rough, but right now, most use cases, you don't actually use more than one network, so it's
And again, we're
to
in the nightmare section right now. We're going to get to the dreams and the good stuff. Okay?
It's not so depressing. The whole talk is not going to be a downer.
Opening the kimono here. You're seeing all the bad stuff.
So some of the interesting issues we've had with it, Neutron is not super happy about handling really rapid API requests, particularly when you're running NSX on the back end. There's a lot of layers there, a lot of synchronization that has to happen, and it gets a little bit bogged down. Race conditions, it turns out, are a huge deal, and synchronizing state between all these virtual devices in a central process, it's a hard problem to solve. We've recently, I think, probably ironed out the last of the major issues, but it's been years.
literally
years.
It's not an easy problem.
The service VM updating is hard. That's actually one of the more expensive processes because you basically have to initialize all of the state. So if we're doing, we've got 100 routers running and we have to reboot them all to do an upgrade to the image, which isn't just an OS update, it's also upgrading the appliance application that's running there or anything else. It basically means initializing state for all 100 routers as rapidly as we can, which ends up being quite taxing on pretty much everything.
It's Nova. It's a great way to knock Neutron right over. Bank, and kick it over.
And DHCP management is one of the things that we actually thought would be super easy, and it turns out it's not. DHCP and metadata, even in bare Neutron, suffers from some pretty heavy delays. 30 to 60 seconds, I think, is about what we were seeing. And it turns out, as we'll get to later, that our own home-built system is actually surprisingly good at that compared to what everybody else is using.
And all these delays that Jeremy's talking about, this impacts our vision. Our vision, one thing I didn't mention, was to have 30-second boot times, 30 to 40-second boot times. So that's a big ask. That's a very fast boot.
And that's including the OS.
Everything, yeah.
Not just until the image starts to boot, but up and running and you can SSH in 30 seconds is the goal. Now, Ceph, because we built it ourselves, partially to be able to run stuff like this and partially, for the hosting side, which is pretty obvious, we tried to use it as extensively as we could. It's backing all of our block storage in DreamCompute. It is behind our Dream Objects, S3 and Swift product.
All of our images stored as well inside Glance.
Which is great because it means you've got one cluster storing all of your data. It's a copy on write operation in order to boot from an image into a volume.
Remember those fast boots
super
we were talking
duper quick.
About?
Yeah, sub-second volume creation from any image in our cluster. Now, we did have one incredibly amazing issue with this. If you remember from the slide before, we've got about 1,100 disks in our cluster. At some point, I think because we started with the cluster at such an early version, it's been through a lot of major upgrades. Our crush map, which is what distributes all of the data, or maps out how the data should be distributed in your cluster, got into a state where our, 20 terabytes of data at the time ended up on 10 hard disks.
Not exactly a massively distributed data store. We had all of these empty disks and 20, all the data.
So the funny thing is we didn't notice because it actually performed pretty well still. But the problem was when you're distributing that much data off of only 10 hard disks, it doesn't happen quickly.
No,
it was
angry.
3 weeks of data redistribution because it was all coming off of 10 spindles.
We have a solution to this as well.
Yep.
So you will not have this happen to you. Learn from us. Okay, so Cinder. So, Nova Volume is no more. Let's Cinder's gonna be great. It's the future, it's another new project. It can't be bad, right? We've heard this before. So Cinder's actually great. I don't want to, again, tell you that it's a bad thing, but there are some interesting things about it. And it was forked from Nova, so it's a great idea. You can get a lot done with it, especially if you're doing some very specific things, like using local storage or LVM, whatever. If you're using something else, say, Ceph, things get a little bit different. because you can't assume that every operation is going to be hyper-fast, right? Deletes in Ceph, in particular, are a little slow. Creates are super fast, which is kind of what you want. The problem is Cinder volume is currently designed to run a single process. And so if you get a whole bunch of operations queued up that are deletes in front of your creates, you know, we actually graph and chart every single, we spin up about 6,000 VMs a day and destroy them, and we graph and chart all of the boot times because we want to get it down, 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 down. We'd see things spike from the 40-second point up to 120, 140 seconds because Cinder was just sitting there going, delete, delete, create, 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 delete. So it's, this is a problem. So we're gonna have a Ceph and Cinder war stories panel tomorrow that I'm on that we'll talk, and Jeremy as well, we'll talk a little bit more about this. And I'm gonna get to in the next section about how we fix this problem. So scaling Cinder beyond kind of private cloud scale, it's not easy.
And I should point out that it's also, it makes sense given where Cinder came from because
absolutely.
It was designed with the idea that once you create a volume, that volume belongs to the node that it was created on because you're dealing with iSCSI things, that it's one-to-one mapping between the Cinder volume host and the storage mechanism. With Ceph, any Cinder volume process can handle any volume in the cluster because they all talk to the same thing. And that's a use case that really wasn't considered when Cinder was created.
Right.
And makes sense because Ceph didn't really exist when it was created. And nothing competitive was really out there either.
So let's talk about Keystone. So like I said, we wanted to do integrated auth, and this seemed like a great idea to us at the time. So we were gonna use the Keystone plugin infrastructure, which is there for just this purpose, right? Well, turns out, no, it's not exactly there for this purpose. And no, it doesn't actually work particularly well for our use case. Also, it happens to change from release to release in breaking ways. So this is kind of on us. We chose to do something here that was kind of out of the norm in a not in the suggested way. We did get it working. But Keystone, as you know, is very central to all of OpenStack. If you make Keystone slow, what you've just done is made all of your OpenStack installation slow. Your entire deployment slows down if Keystone is slow. So yeah, we had a solution to this one as well, and it's actually kind of a funny one. We'll get there. So now the realities. It's not all bad news.
We've been working on this for a very long time, and we feel like we've finally gotten over the hump, and things are starting to work the way that we're hoping they would. Image building, it's actually a surprisingly interesting problem. We've come up with a methodology where I literally just throw reboot into rc.local and let them cycle. It's kind of amazing the sorts of bugs that you uncover in the boot process by letting it do that. In particular, Ubuntu Precise, we found there's a deadlock in mount all. About, I think, 5% of our boots were just deadlocking, saying it couldn't mount some random thing, like temp or something else. And it's a bug that is, well, there are two bugs. One of them was flagged for backport and forgotten, and the other one was apparently just ignored.
By the way, we are having conversations with the appropriate people about this to get it fixed.
We actually
it is the type of thing that you turn up when you do this kind of testing.
Yeah. So. We had a pretty good conversation with them today, and I think we finally talked to the right people, and things are going to get all ironed out.
News to me.
Yeah, GitHub, this is where we've been storing some of our tools, the Nova and Cinder auditors, and I think I've got a Keystone thing up there. Basically, every time we encounter a problem, we write a script either to fix it or at least to report on it. And toss them up on GitHub. Now, the layer 3 in network virtualization. We've discussed this a bit in the pains, but it actually turns out that once you deal with it for a while, it starts to work. We hit a bit of a milestone about, 2 months ago, mm-hmm. when we decided we weren't really sure if we were going to get the rug working as well as we needed it to. So what we decided to do was talk to VMware, get a cluster set up, just a small one, a test scale on one of our hypervisor boxes, and just put like a death match together between
literally
their layer 3 services with all the bare bones Neutron stuff against our layer 3 services with Akanda and the rug. And we ran for 2 days, 3 days, something like that, like over a weekend, and just compared times, the same boot time tests that we do for everything else, where we find out how long does it take before CloudNet launches, until CloudNet finishes, and then you can SSH in. And it turned out that we were actually like 2 to 3 times as fast. We've talked to the Neutron guys. Apparently, they are quite aware of some of the timing issues, particularly with the metadata service in Neutron. And I think Aaron said Juno was going to see a lot of fixes
right
there.
And,
so it's looking promising.
Another point on this front, this is not a statement that the L3 services from VMware aren't good. They're actually great. But there were a couple things that were specific to us that they didn't make sense. One, no IPv6 support, which is something we said was one of our tenets that we really wanted to have. We were open 2 months ago to just saying, well, we gave it the good old college try and IPv6, bye. You know, there's also some other things. There's DHCP, the way that you have to do DHCP in the L3 services for NSX are very different than the way that we're doing them, mm-hmm. and we actually end up preferring and being able to scale ours better. So yeah, we were surprised here, actually. We were expecting to be defeated, but we didn't.
Yeah, we also, one interesting thing is, as a bit of a workaround for those times when DHCP does lag a little bit, we configured all of our images to try using config drive first, which it turns out Nova just kind of does for you, even if you don't tell it to. Because there is an option to always use config drive, and basically, as far as I can tell, what that does is disables DHCP. But config drive is actually always running, even if you don't tell it to. So using CloudInit, it will just look, try to mount something with the right label, config-2, if I remember correctly, which is kind of odd.
Yes.
And then it works. And it actually allows your image to boot up a little bit faster. It might take a little bit of a while for the networking to actually get packets in. But it means that you don't have that 2-minute timeout or whatever it is for DHCP.
Right.
If you end up being just a few seconds slow. So as Jonathan said earlier, our testing consists of basically spinning up about 6,000 VMs a day, tearing them down instantly, and just graphing at every point where we can determine something has completed an important stage in the boot process. We graph it as a data point. And then if anything fails, if at the end we can't SSH in, or we see in the log that CloudInit wasn't able to do its thing, we graph that as another data point. So we have failure counts, success counts, and timing info for all of it.
And this keeps us up at night. We we lead off every stand-up meeting every morning looking at what our current success rate is, how fast are our boot times, how many fails do we get, why. So this has been all of our conversation lately, which is good.
Actually a good thing. Our QA guy actually wrote a little script that uses PhantomJS to download all the graphs and just email them every morning. It's pretty great. It's a nice,
well,
nice way to wake up.
It's great when you get back the 99.998% you know, success. It's not so great when you get the 85%.
Now, Ceph, I don't know if the CERN guys are in the room, but apparently yes. Apparently, we're tied for the biggest running operational Ceph clusters in the world at 3 petabytes. And I'm sure, as they'd be happy to tell you, it's not always great. Any cluster that size, no matter what workload it's running, you're always going to run into some problems. Just like with OpenStack, after we had that data distribution problem, I basically spent 2 days just writing Nagios plugins to check every single last thing that I could figure out we could have caught if we had known to look for it. Those are also up on GitHub under my own repo right there.
Because to be fair, most of these problems are caused by human error that you should really be monitoring for. I mean, if you're going to monitor one thing that's the most unreliable in your cloud, it's the people who run it.
Yeah. And honestly, we don't know how long it had been in this state. We don't know if it was somebody who fat-fingered something or if it was an upgrade gone bad. And that's on us, and now that's what all this stuff is supposed to catch. And even if you're a small guy and you can't, you know, afford InkTank's professional services, they're on IRC,
they're very helpful.
The mailing list. You'll be hard-pressed to find any time of day or night where you won't get a response within a couple of minutes on something that's gone horribly wrong or horribly great if you feel like just
or
sharing your experiences.
You can get Sage's cell phone number, which I figured out, and that's a really great way to get things going. I'm not sure you'll be able to do that, but. So let's talk about scaling Cinder. More workers, less problems, right? That's anything you're going to be operating at scale, you're going to need to be able to divvy up work amongst a bunch of different workers. You can't just have a single threaded operation sitting there doing things and pulling things off a queue. It's senseless. So, you know, we tried a bunch of different things. You know, we tried some of the stuff that we heard the CERN guys were doing. And what we ended up doing, and the thing that we're working on lately, is we actually implemented an RPC driver that will intelligently send certain operations to different topics. And then we made a small patch to Cinder volume such that it could bind to only specific topics. In this way, we can create a pool of different, you know, different pools of Cinder workers, a bunch of Cinder volume workers, that can process only specific things. So I can have a pool of Cinder volume nodes that are designed purely to make fast operations happen as quickly as possible, and a separate pool to relegate the slow operations to so that they don't slow down the fast ones. And this helps even out the lumpiness. So what we were seeing in our boot times is like this spikes, and it's now starting to go like this, and I'm hoping that with this RPC change, yeah, which we're talking to the Cinder devs about.
Well, if I remember correctly, that one line patch to Cinder was actually a bug fix.
Yeah,
it was a feature that they were supposed to
Cinder,
support and didn't
yes.
work quite right.
Note to everyone, if you configure Cinder to Cinder volume to listen on a different topic, it just won't. But now it will.
Yeah.
We're gonna upstream that, so. All right. Keystone. So we don't always have the answer to these problems where we say, here's the smart trick we did to fix this problem. In this particular case, we met with some of the Keystone devs and talked to them a lot about our use case and talked to some people on our security team and did a lot of thinking and decided to give up. And we went back to vanilla Keystone. And you know what? Life is much better. And at the end of the day, we actually prefer it this way, mm-hmm, now that we're there, because we actually have the ability to create a bunch of different users in a very, you know, nice way. We can integrate it with our control panel.
This is where failures are actually kind of good sometimes, because it makes you rethink why you're, you know, using some feature or developing something. Because after you've been developing it for a year, you know, circumstances change, and it's good to go back.
Descoping is okay. We did that in a couple other places that I haven't mentioned, especially on the networking side. And if you have questions about that, we're going to have a couple minutes left. We'll talk about those as well.
All right, so on to the dreams. What did we get right in the end?
Fewer slides in this part, guys.
Yeah. So packaging and testing, we, like I'm sure probably half the room here do, we roll our own packages. We use Jenkins job builder, FPM, package everything inside of a virtual env in dev packages, because everything's running on Ubuntu Precise. And talks for dependency management, basically, right? thanks to Jenkins Job Builder, we were able to pretty easily target any particular patch set or tree branch in a Git repo. So we can pull in new stuff. We can run our own patches on top of something if we decide to fork. And it ends up being really flexible, and we're liking it a lot. It works really well. Any packages that get built through this, which for most cases happens on a nightly basis or as it detects changes going into upstream GitHub, they automatically get rolled out to our staging cluster, burn in for a little while before a manual upgrade promotion into our production cluster. White box switches, as I mentioned earlier with Cumulus, who are a great partner, they've been public for how long now?
I don't know, 6 months maybe?
Yeah.
A while.
Yeah. They're pretty awesome. Basically, you end up with a Linux box running essentially Debian. In our particular case, they show up with just 48 Ethernet interfaces that show up as 10 gig, and then 440 gig that we use for interconnects. You can, I think, on the gear we have, if you want, do QSFP on those and get 4 10 gig ports out of every 40. If you really need some more density. The newer Trident 2 stuff that's just starting to trickle out now, you're looking at, I think, 36 40 gig ports or 4 times that number of 10 gig ports, which is just insane.
The other nice thing about this is when you're buying white box switches, wow, do you save some cash.
Mm-hmm.
The list price on one of these switches is about $6,000 if you're buying one. If you're building a cloud, you are not buying one. You are buying a lot of them, and it drives that cost down a lot. And Cumulus Linux is actually really inexpensive as well. Mm-hmm. Their pricing is also published. No games. Really, really great.
Yeah, it's...
And they're doing demos with us at our booth throughout the week. So
a couple times a day, through Thursday, I think.
We'll actually SSH into yesterday. One of our switches, and you can see us poke around on it, which sounds
like
a terrible
idea, right?
Don't
tell anybody. It's actually the live cluster.
Yeah. Plug your ears, guys.
One of the crazier things, which I actually didn't realize until I was putting together a talk about 6 months ago, as cheap as the switches are, where you really save is in the interconnects. We run just copper for the 10 gig because we're doing pretty short runs. But even with copper, other vendors were going to be charging us like $600 to $800 a cable, which is absurd. And we're, at least a year ago, last time we had to buy some, we're paying like $60 a pop. At the end of the day, I think our costs were about 10% of what we were using for our commodity or our hosting infrastructure, using the normal players in the game.
All right, we're running close to our end, so we're going to speed it up a little bit. Oh, good, this is the last slide before the end. So go ahead.
On to the Ceph stuff. It's probably one of the better storage platforms that I've used, and I don't say that just because we developed it. Being in the hosting business for 16 years, we've seen a lot of crap come through our door with storage devices. Ceph really does solve all of the problems that we've had with everything else and introduces not too many new issues, comparatively. Lightning fast boots. The OpenStack use case is pretty incredible for it. Because you literally upload an image in a glance, preferably a raw image. But with cloud in it, we can build these images that are like 3 gigabytes, so it's not super huge. It gets copied into a volume. The moment you start up an instance, it's, 3/10 of a second to do that. And then it starts booting. Cloud in it will actually just automatically resize that volume to whatever size you want it to be, which is almost just as instantaneous. And so you can run an 80 gig instance off of a 3 gig image, and you're ready to run a website in like 30 seconds.
My favorite thing about Ceph, as the person who runs the business unit, is that I can operate it with a very small number of people because it's self-managing, self-healing. That doesn't mean that these guys aren't sometimes pulling their hair out and working really hard on it. But it has enabled us to be doing something that would normally take a team 10 times that large minimum to do with a couple people.
Yeah, unless we're doing an upgrade, because it's a cluster of roughly 100 machines, and it has to be fairly well orchestrated because, particularly with major version upgrades, you have to have a very set regimen of the order in which you upgrade everything because disk formats change and all this other stuff. But outside of those instances, we sleep well.
Yes.
Nothing really goes wrong, thankfully, as long as we...
Everybody.
If it does, it's usually our fault.
Yep. So what does this all mean? Well, good news. The beta is expanding on May 27th. We're looking forward to adding in more people. A lot of you have already signed up. We're really excited to scale it up now, and we really think that we've got this thing working. So we're looking forward to your feedback, especially from you guys in the OpenStack community, because if you do see things that crop up, you'll help us find out what the problem is and get it fixed. So the future's bright. We're out of the weeds. Why aren't we going straight to GA? Well, we want it to be perfect. No, we don't want it to be perfect. We want it to be really good, right? And we feel like it's good now, but it's not quite where we want it to be. So come help us out, make that happen. Come by our booth and see a demo of Cumulus Linux running on our white box switches in our actual cloud. And come see us tomorrow in the Ceph and Cinder War Stories talk.
11:50?
I think so. Yeah. Thanks. Questions? I think we have maybe time for a couple. If you could go to the mic, that would be great.
What hardware vendor were you using for the ODM switches?
I think they've changed names now.
They have.
Now they're Agama, I think?
Yes.
Agama.
And what was the previous name?
Delta. Networks.
Okay.
Another
question. You mentioned you guys are doing a vCPU to CPU ratio of 2:1. Mm-hmm. Is that 2 vCPU to 1 hyperthread or actual core?
Actual core.
Actual core. Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
So you mentioned about performance. So do you use something like Rally to test performance? And you also mentioned a second question for that is like 6,000 VMs booting at an instance. So it's like currently Keystone runs in an eventlet based model, so do you use something like Apache or something like web
yes.
server?
We use Apache for Keystone, mm-hmm. and as for using Rally, we do not. We have our own test suites that we use,
okay.
But we are planning on, you know, we've done some Tempest stuff as well. Now with RefStack coming, you know, there's some other things we're planning on doing there. So testing is important to us, all the things, bring
okay,
them on.
Okay, so right now you're not using Rally?
Not yet.
Okay,
no.
But you package, say, Apache and all those in a virtual and kind of thing? Something
well, not
like
Apache.
No, it's basically the OpenStack code and a few other extra things, but all of the Apache and other system services, we're just using Ubuntu's packages.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Anyone else?
You mentioned that you created a Nagios plugin for Ceph.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with the monitoring of the other parts of OpenStack?
Well, we're not doing a whole lot of monitoring of the rest of OpenStack just yet. Mostly it's of our performance tests. If any of the endpoints go down, they're going to catch it. We will eventually explicitly monitor every endpoint individually. We're just not there yet.
Yeah, we are using Logstash, Grafana, Graphite. You know, we've got a lot of things in place, and I guess we just haven't written every single monitor yet.
Yeah, yeah, basically everything's being looked at. It's not alerting anybody.
You mentioned that you guys gave up on some changes you're making to Keystone. So maybe I missed it, but what was not vanilla about your initial Keystone?
We had implemented a custom plugin to Keystone.
Custom
that would
middleware. Right?
Middleware or plugin? I'm not exactly Rosario. You can probably help me answer this question.
Yeah.
Was it a plugin? Is that what it was? So it was a plugin, and it was hooking into our auth to make it possible to use those credentials, and because of both the way that the Keystone plugin mechanism was implemented and the fact that it was unstable, meaning it was changing in a breaking way from version to version, we couldn't get it to go fast, and we felt it was going to be a burden to maintain. So we just said, forget it.
Okay. And so just one more question on the Ceph. You guys have, I guess, shared storage across all the nodes. They
yep.
see the same storage?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I think that's it for time.
Yeah, I think we're maybe out of time. Come and right. talk to us later.
Yeah, well, we'll be both at the booth
yep.
quite a bit for the next couple days.
Thank you.